Going to the moon back in the late 60s and 70s was a little bit rushed, with more politics involved than science. After all, it was a space race, and only for the sake of beating the Russians to the moon. Nowadays, going back to the moon is a possibility again, and it's nothing but rushed. The new Artemis project is putting Americans back on the moon, and this time they're going there to stay. Yes, you heard correctly. American astronauts are going to stay on the moon to perform scientific experiments in preparations to go to the red planet afterwards. Today we're going to talk about the 13 secondary payloads that are going to be aboard the first Artemis mission back to the moon, Artemis 1. Make sure to check the video we made a while back about the NASA Artemis project. But let us refresh your memories about the Artemis 1 mission. The Artemis 1 mission will be the first mission to the moon. It will be an uncrewed mission used to demonstrate the readiness and efficiency of the different systems of the Artemis project, the Orion spacecraft, the Space Launch System rocket, and the re-entry and recovery systems. Now, the 13 payloads that we mentioned earlier are all small satellites. So small, in fact, they are called CubeSats. You wouldn't think a CubeSat would do much science, but believe me, it will. Actually, the idea of CubeSats aren't exclusive to the Artemis project. They've been used before many times in low Earth orbits, producing some pretty interesting science as well. So much so that Avi Mandel, a scientist in NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, said back in 2015, "I believe the future looks bright for science on CubeSats, due to their fantastic versatility. Once we understand how to design these platforms, the possibilities are endless as to what we can do with them." This time, the tiny satellites will put low Earth orbit behind them and hit straight to the moon, exploring different orbits and different altitudes above the moon, which will allow for completely different and exciting science. If you're wondering how tiny CubeSats are, well, they're actually measured in units, or U, which is the equivalent of 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters, and they can be any multiple of units, up to 6 units. Besides being so small, CubeSats also have the advantage of being low cost, which enables different sectors, public, private, or even individuals, to build their own CubeSats to be launched into space and explore. But how will the CubeSats actually reach the moon? We mentioned they'll be part of the Artemis 1 mission, which means they'll be on board the Space Launch System rocket. More specifically, all of the 13 CubeSats will be connected to the Orion Stage Adapter, which in turn is connected to the Orion spacecraft. And when the rocket releases the spacecraft, the payloads will get released, as well as each CubeSat will be on its way to take its place in orbit. Now let's talk about the CubeSats themselves. Let's start with the satellite called Lunar Flashlight. This satellite is very special because it's going to be the first mission looking for water ice inside craters on the moon's south pole using a near-infrared laser. The craters under study are so dark because they never see the sunlight, which makes them the perfect hiding place for different kinds of molecules to get trapped. The Lunar Flashlight will be in orbit around the moon for 2 months, and it will perform its science by shooting a laser beam into the dark craters. And the reflection off these craters would be met by 4 reflectometers on board the CubeSat. The reflection would be analyzed to figure out the composition of the crater and the location of water ice. Another aspect that makes the Lunar Flashlight so special is that it will be the first CubeSat to use a green propulsion system, designed by NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center and Jet Propulsion Laboratory, alongside Georgia Tech University. The new green propulsion system is based not on hydrazine, but on a green monopropellant developed by the US Air Force Research Laboratory. The system will eventually weigh only 6 kilograms, 12 pounds, and can deliver over 3,000 newton seconds of total impulse. The new propellant is safe, less toxic, more chemically stable, and easier to handle. It's also efficient in delivering higher specific impulse. The second CubeSat has to do with water as well, called the Lunar Polar Hydrogen Mapper, or Lunah HMAP for short. Developed by Arizona State University and NASA's JPL, will be used to scan lunar craters and other different areas to detect hydrogen. Weighing about 18 kilograms or 40 pounds, the cube will be put in a polar, low-altitude orbit around the moon for 2 months, during which the satellite will complete more than 140 orbits and perform science using two neutron spectrometers on board. The neutron spectrometers will measure the energy of neutrons that impact on the lunar surface. And from this information, the presence of hydrogen will be known, which in turn tell us a lot about the distribution of water in the near surface of the moon. NASA prides itself that the Lunah H map will make the most detailed and high-quality map of water distribution across the moon's south pole. The next CubeSat is called Lunar IceCube, and it's going to spend 6 months in an elliptical orbit around the moon performing experiments to look for vapor, liquid, and ice water. Morehead State University is leading the process of building and fabrication of the Lunar IceCube, alongside NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center and the privately owned Busek Company in Massachusetts. The Lunar IceCube will have a single onboard scientific instrument called Birches, which is an infrared spectrometer to search for water and all its forms, not restricted to only ice water and dark craters, like the case in the Lunar Flashlight Cube. The Lunar IceCube will also be able to characterize other elements in the infrared spectrum of light. The three CubeSats we've discussed so far will predict the locations of water in such high accuracy so that future landing missions can land directly where the water is and not waste time scouting around. The three CubeSats either search for, map, or analyze water and water ice on the moon. But why the sudden interest in water on the moon, and especially on its south pole? That's because future Artemis astronauts are going to visit the South Pole for the first time ever. And locating where the water might be in this new area of the moon will help astronauts take advantage of it in drinking and producing fuel. No one expressed this point better than John Baker, the Lunar Flashlight Project Manager at Jet Propulsion Laboratory, when he said, "A technology demonstration mission like Lunar Flashlight, which is lower cost and fills a specific gap in our knowledge, can help us better prepare for an extended NASA presence on the moon, as well as test key technologies that may be used in future missions." The next CubeSat is called LunIR, which will perform multiple flybys of the moon, during which the CubeSat will take images of the moon and its surrounding to provide more knowledge regarding the structure and environment around the moon. Moreover, LunIR will demonstrate different CubeSat's technologies, including maneuvering in space. Not all 13 payloads are studying space, though. This next CubeSat is actually quite different. It's called Biosentinel, and it's the only biological experiment among the 13 payloads. The experiment's goal is to develop a device that senses the effect of outer space radiation on living organisms by studying how yeast reacts in space beyond low Earth orbit. The next CubeSat will go on an adventure to interplanetary space to study the sun's radiation. It's called Cusp, and it will act as a space weather indicator where it will observe solar particles and solar magnetic fields before they reach Earth and cause any harm, like interfering with communication systems or power grids. Next, we have a pretty interesting CubeSat that's going to study something entirely different. It goes by the name NEA Scout, which is short for Near Earth Asteroid Scout. Yes, this CubeSat is going to perform flybys of an asteroid to increase our understanding of them and the possible risk they pose to Earth. NASA has also reserved 3 slots for the public to design their own CubeSats. The administration held a competition and 3 teams won the chance to further develop their ideas. The first winner is the team CIS Lunar Explorers, who is developing a CubeSat to go around the moon that runs on water. Odd, right? The idea is to use a water electrolysis propulsion system, which entails the use of electricity to break the bond between hydrogen and oxygen in water molecules and produce fuel. This kind of propulsion system is totally new, and testing it in space will give the team a great advantage and opportunity into the space flight sector. The second winner is the team CUE3 from the University of Colorado Boulder. This team wants to set new records with its CubeSat that's going on an orbit 10 times more distant than the moon is, which demonstrates how far a CubeSat can go in space. Additionally, the CubeSat will act as a proof of concept that communication technology developed by the university can perform well in space and at a faraway orbit from Earth. The third and final winner is Team Miles, This team consists mainly of citizen scientists, and they are developing a deep space CubeSat that's going to demonstrate two new technologies. The first is a computer system that's going to autonomously guide the CubeSat to fly in space, and the second is a novel propulsion system that uses plasma thrusters. If you've been paying attention so far, you've noticed that there are still three payloads that we haven't yet discussed. These three payloads belong to international partners whom NASA gave the chance to participate in the Artemis 1 payloads. The first two of the International CubeSats belong to the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, JAXA, and the University of Tokyo. First, we have the Equilibrium Lunar Earth Point 6U spacecraft. This CubeSat will make multiple flybys around the Moon, but will eventually get into Earth's orbit to study the radiation around the Earth and how it might affect future space missions and astronauts. Furthermore, the CubeSat will study plasma surrounding the Earth by taking images of Earth's plasmasphere. The second JAXA CubeSat is called the Outstanding Moon Exploration Technologies, demonstrated by Nano Semi-Hard Impactor. Yes, all this is just the name. This CubeSat, with the difficult name, is going to monitor and study the radiation around and on the surface of the Moon. It will also act as a technology demonstration for low-cost and small missions to explore the surface of the Moon. The third and final International CubeSat belongs to Italy, where the Italian Space Agency supervises the building process by the Italian company Argotech. The CubeSat is called Argo Moon, and it will have three main goals to achieve. 1. Argo Moon will be very close to the rocket's interim cryogenic propulsion stage, in order to test the ability of performing science in such close proximity to a propulsion stage. 2. Recording and documenting of the interim cryogenic propulsion stage, in addition as well as the deployment of the 13 payloads. 3. Finally, Argo Moon will test optical communication systems between the CubeSats and Earth. The Artemis 1 mission is launching with the 13 payloads sometime in 2020, if no further delays take place because of the COVID-19 pandemic.